हरे कृष्णा, वेलकम टू दिस कंटिन्यूएशन ऑफ द डिस्कशन ऑफ दोज 18 डेज। टुडे विल डिस्कस द फिफ्थ डे ऑफ द वॉर। ड्यूरिंग दिस डे द बैटल्स वेंट ऑन अलोंग फेमिलियर लाइन्स वाइल ऑल्सो इंट्रोड्यूसिंग सम न्यू सिग्निफिकेंट बैटल्स। द फेमिलियर लाइन्स मीन्स दैट Bhishma fought with Arjuna, along Drona fought with Drishtadyumna, Bhima fought with Duryodhana. But along with that, Satyaki was involved in a major way. Shikhandi also tried to target Bhishma because when Bhishma had been asked, or when Bhishma had been assessing the two armies, at that time he had said that he would not raise weapons against Shikhandi because Shikhandi had been a woman in his previous life. And Bhishma, as a warrior, felt that he had decided that he would see Shikhandi's gender not from this life but from his previous life also. And therefore, a warrior would not raise weapons against a woman, even if he was not presently a woman. We'll discuss about Shikhandi more on the 10th day. Now, along with that, Satyaki came into play in a significant way today. Satyaki is among the few Yadus who's extremely close to Krishna. And because of the closeness to Krishna, and he was also close to Arjuna because he was a student of Arjuna. He was, like all other major Kshatriyas at those times, a person who had trained in Dronacharya's Gurukul. However, he was relatively younger, not so young as to be entirely the next generation, like Abhimanyu and Upapandavas, the sons of the Pandavas. But not entirely old enough to be in the generation of Arjuna. And he continued his training under Arjuna. Whenever Arjuna would meet with the Yadus, be it when Arjuna stayed in the Yadu kingdom of Dwarka, or when the Dwarkavasis visited the Pandavas in Indraprastha, Satyaki learned further, building on what he had learned from Drona in the Gurukul. So thus Satyaki was a student of both Drona and Arjuna. Because of his ties with both of them, Satyaki was among the few Yadu warriors who was fighting on the side of the Pandavas. We know that at the start of the war, both the Kauravas and the Pandavas, represented by Duryodhan and Arjun, had sought the assistance of Krishna. And Krishna had said that, because you are related, both of you are related to me, so I will personally not fight on anyone's side. And moreover, I have resolved not to raise weapons anymore. Therefore, too, also, I will not fight. So, I will be available as a counselor on one side, and my entire Narayan Sena will be available on the other side. So, you can now, because Arjuna is younger, and because I saw Arjuna earlier when I woke up after the arrival of both of you, so I will give Arjuna the preference of choice, a priority of choice. And Arjuna unhesitatingly chose Krishna. He knew that God is greater than all the power in the universe because all power in the universe ultimately comes from God. Whereas Duryodhan had material calculations and he saw that if Krishna is not going to fight, he thought rather that, then what is the value of Krishna? If he's a non-combatant, then having warriors and a huge army that will fight is far preferable. So that's how he got the Yadu army on his side, and some Yadu generals also came on this side with him, but most Yadavas followed Balram and remained neutral. And Balram went on pilgrimage. The other Yadavas didn't go on pilgrimage during the Kurukshetra war, but they maintained neutrality as Krishna had maintained. But their neutrality was complete non-involvement, unlike Krishna's, which was passive or non-combatant involvement. So the point of this background is that Satyaki fought on the side of the Pandavas, and he was a great warrior, both with his double training from Drona and Arjuna, and as well as his heroic spirit. They made him soon a prominent warrior among the Pandavas. And on this day, he fought heroically. He charged against Drona and attacked Drona again and again and again. On this day, there were new battles also being fought. Now, what would happen is that, say, two warriors are fighting with each other. So at that time, both warriors, say, they would say Arjuna and Bhishma are fighting, or say Drona Drishtadyumna are fighting. Now they would fight and fight and fight, and if anyone seemed to be gaining an upper hand, then immediately what would be changed is that at that particular time, the warriors may be aided by other warriors who come to their support, and on the opposite side also other warriors might come in, and that's how the war might not remain between those two alone. So in a sense, a war is both like a individual sports and a team sports. So in individual sports, and if you have tennis or chess, it's basically, especially if you're talking of singles tennis, then it's one player fighting against one player. In contrast, if you have team sports like football or baseball or basketball, where it is a one team facing against another team. Now, even when there is one team facing against another team, there might be individual contests between two people. But those contests alone are not the defining contests. And those may not be the contests that go on steadily. So, for example, if we consider cricket, it's a team sport. But at the same time, there might be some defining or striking contests, say the matches within the matches, as they are said, the face-off between a star bowler on one side and the star batsman on the other side. However, it may also happen that on a particular day, some batsman might be in great form or some bowler might be in great form. And when that happens, then so this not star bowler might be giving a stellar performance, and therefore that bowler might become the prominent bowler on that day, and that bowler might face off with the batsman, the star batsman on the other side. So just as in sports it is said that, class is permanent, form is temporary, form may come and go, but somebody who has class, that class stays for a long time, and those with class will regain form eventually. And those who are in great form, if they don't have class, then they will descend to their normal level, which may not be extraordinary. The point is that extraordinary players may also have ordinary days at times, and ordinary players may have extraordinary days at times. So similarly, with respect to warriors, that although there are skills involved, although there is training involved, but beyond it all, there is innate caliber. And that caliber defines itself in the long run. That caliber defines the warriors in the long run. At the same time, sometimes, on some days, some warriors may have an off day. They fight, but they're just overwhelmed on that day by a lesser warrior. Just like in tennis, sometimes the world champion may be upset by some unranked player. Now, if that unranked player, that unranked player's performance may herald that unranked player attaining a superstar status in the future, or it might be like a flash in the pan, where that unranked player defeats this champion and then in the next round gets defeated themselves. So my point here is that in the Kurukshetra war, there were times when lesser warriors also rose to greater significance. And there were, of course, times when the main warriors had their prominent days. So Satyaki, on this day, as well as on several other days, he fought heroically. Still, he was no match to Drona. Drona had superior experience and he had superior expertise. And over time, on this day, although Satyaki fought heroically, and several times he seemed to be gaining an upper hand on Drona. But as the war went on and on that day, eventually Drona started gaining the upper hand. And once Drona gained the upper hand, then we could say Satyaki was in a better form on that day. But that form went up and came down. And Drona, as his class, which was far better than Satyaki's, so Drona slowly but surely started besting Satyaki. As Satyaki started getting exhausted, outclassed, wounded, it became clear that Drona might overwhelm and even kill Satyaki. So Bhima on that day had been fighting first with Duryodhana, then with Bhishma, then with other warriors. And when he saw Satyaki in danger, he charged up to Drona and he challenged Drona and he took the brunt of Drona's attack, and Satyaki was saved. So Satyaki was involved again in another act of extraordinary heroism on the 14th day of the Kurukshetra war, when Arjuna had taken a vow to bring Jayadrath down before sunset on that day. And after Arjuna had penetrated deep into the Kaurava camp, Yudhishthira felt anxious. What if Arjuna gets trapped in the Kaurava army just as Abhimanyu got trapped yesterday? So he asked Satyaki to go with the inside. And Satyaki obliged after ensuring that Yudhishthira was protected by the other warriors. Satyaki had been deputed by Arjuna to protect Yudhishthira. But once Satyaki entered, he followed the trail of devastation that Arjuna had wrecked, and he came close to Arjuna. But what Arjuna had achieved in a trailblazing way, for Satyaki to emulate that was exhausting. And by the time he reached Arjuna's side, he was nearing the end of his energy. And that's how Bhurishrava, an opponent, almost got the best of him. At Krishna's behest, Arjuna intervened and saved Satyaki. So Satyaki had his days of great heroism, but still, his class was not the same of, say, Arjuna or Bhima or Bhishma or Drona. And that brings us to an important point to learn, that courage is important. The heroic spirit of fighting is essential in any warrior. However, courage is not a replacement for competence. Of course, better than competence is excellence. But at the basic level, competence is essential. Sometimes we may watch movies in which there is a one-man army. One person holds against an entire army and overpowers an entire army. Now, to actually be able to do that, this one person needs to be superlatively skilled. Otherwise, the sheer number of the opposition will overpower. So if we consider a pendulum, the courage will be on one side of the pendulum and competence will be on another side. If there is only courage but no competence, then that will be foolhardiness. That will lead to recklessness, and that can be self-destructive. So in real life, if someone just has the fighting spirit but doesn't have the fighting skills, then that is not very safe. Courage does not replace competence. Somebody may have the fighting spirit, but they're not trained to shoot properly with a gun. Then they may have the gun, but they may not be able to hit the target, and their opponents will hit them. So that's why the Kshatriyas would have rigorous training. And Arjuna, he's known as Gandiva. He's known as Gudakesha. Although he had this enormously powerful weapon, the Gandiva bow, which was bestowed to him by the gods, still, to be able to use that properly, he had trained enormously prior to acquiring that, and he continued his vigorous training in austerity even after acquiring that. And so only courage without competence will lead to a foolhardiness. On the other hand, if there is competence but no courage, then that may lead to spinelessness. Because one may have the ability to fight, but if one doesn't have the spirit, then one may think, oh, this battle is too difficult. Why fight it? And one may not resist. One may not counter injustice or atrocity when one faces it. So the ideal situation is where there is both courage and competence. And that means we need the will to fight and the skill to fight. In particular situations that we are in, when we deal with life, when we face life's difficulties, we need to have the inner will and the outer skill. And one does not substitute for the other while functioning in the material world. Yes, when we want to serve the Lord is pleased only by our will, our intention, in a transcendental sense. Just like a mother might be pleased even with the stammering words of a baby, or of a newborn child, or of a growing child. And that is wonderful. That is a loving reciprocation between the baby trying to speak and the mother appreciating the effort to speak. But if a public speech is to be given to address a large number of people, that time if a person is stammering and struggling, the audience may not be as sympathetic or as appreciative as a mother might be. So the person who is going to be a public speaker can't rely only on the will. They also have to develop skill. Now, even if somebody is speaking the message of God, one needn't have excellence in public speaking, but at least one has to have some amount of competence. And just having the intention to speak in public, that is a foundation, no doubt. But the intention has to be complemented by training. So when we have the combination of will and skill, or in the battlefield context, courage and competence, then we can rise to success. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.